Hello students, welcome back to my channel Mind Your Exam. So in this video we will be continuing chapter 6 back exercise questions, and from this video we'll be doing the programming questions. We'll be continuing the programming questions that we have already started in the previous video. Okay, so in this class the first question that we would be taking up is write a program to generate this sequence -5, 10, -15, 20, -25 up to a given number n that will be entered by the user. Okay, so n and n is an integer that will be input by the user, and you have to generate this particular sequence. So you have to print this sequence. Now to print this sequence, there are three things that you have to keep in mind. Firstly, the negative sign is alternating here. So the first value has a negative sign, then there is a positive sign or no sign, then again a negative sign, and so on. So alternatively, you need to apply the negative sign to the value that you are printing. Now the value that you are printing is also changing. It is increasing by a factor of 5. Okay, so every time the value that you are printing, the value itself is increasing by 5 if we leave apart the sign. Okay, and the last thing is that you have to print the sequence till whatever number is entered by the user. Now that number can be a positive number or a negative number, so you have to check this condition keeping the sign of the value in mind. Okay, so what we do in this question, we first take the number as an input from the user and we convert it into an integer by performing type conversion, because the input functions automatically converts the user input as a string. So we need to perform explicit type conversion here. Now we are maintaining two variables. The variable val stores the value that will be printed. Initially we want to print the value -5. So we are storing 5 here, and we'll keep a separate variable that will keep track of the sign, the negative sign, whether it has to be printed or not. So count is the variable that will keep track of whether negative sign has to be printed or not. And how that will be done? See, when you're printing the first value, minus sign is printed. So we can say -1 raised to the power of 1. 1, because it is the first value, will give you -1. Okay. Then if you say for the second value, -1 raised to the power 2, it will give you +1. So here the sign would be positive, or no negative sign would be printed. So this is the logic that I'm following here. You can make any other logic if you want, or you can follow this program if you understand this correctly. Okay. Now what we are basically doing is we are using a while loop. In the while loop, we are performing a condition checking. We are saying that whatever number is entered by the user, as long as the number we have just printed is not equal to that particular number, then keep on incrementing the loop, or keep on printing the statements, keep on executing the statements that are present inside the while loop. Okay, so every time what we are printing, we basically have to print the value multiplied by the sign, and the sign is calculated as -1 raised to the power count, and count will be the value which number you are actually printing. If you are printing the first number, count will have the value 1. If you are printing the second number, it will have the value 2, and so on. Okay, now every time you'll have to increment count by 1, and you'll also have to increment the value by +5. Okay, so as long as the loop runs, your values would be printed. So let's see, when I execute this program, if I have to run it till say -25, so this is what the program has printed: -5, 10, -15, and so on till -25. I'm again executing this, and let's say we have to print it till 20. So when I say 20, it has printed all the numbers in the sequence till 20. Okay, so coming to the second question, the second question says write a program to find the sum of this particular sequence. Now you don't have to print the sequence, you have to find the sum. Okay, and again the number n would be entered by the user. So you have to take the user input. I have taken the user input in the variable num, and initially I have assigned the variable sum to be 0. Okay, so let's make it sum 1 or sum, because we don't want it to interfere with any kind of keyword that the Python has provided. So our sum, or the addition of all these series, the numbers in the series, will be stored in this variable sum1, and I have initialized it to 0. So in the series, you can see that every value is in the form 1 divided by n cube, or n raised to the power 3. And the first term is also in the form 1 divided by 1 raised to the power 3, which is 1 itself. So it can be written as 1 by 1 or equal to 1. Then the second number is in the form 1 divided by 2 cube, or 2 raised to power 3, which is 8. Then 1 divided by 3 cube, which is 3 raised to power 3, or 27, and so on. So what we are doing, we are using a for loop, because we have to start, we have to iterate over the values 1, starting from 1. The denominator here would start from 1, and it will go till n. Since we have to include n, that is why in the loop variable, I have written num plus 1. If you write num here, the value num will not be taken up by the loop variable, because we know that the last value that the loop variable accepts is this value minus 1. Okay, so every time you are calculating a value and you are adding it to the variable that stores the sum. So initially sum was stored in the value in the variable sum1, and the value that you are adding to it is 1 divided by the loop variable raised to the power 3. Okay, so 1 divided by 1 cube in the first case, then in the second case 1 divided by 2 cube, and so on. Okay, so let's execute this. If we have to enter the numbers, say 4, so this is the sum of the series that you will be getting. If I again execute and if I enter 1, so the sum of the series is 1 only, because only the first term will be printed or will be used in the addition. Coming to the next question. The next question says, write a program to find the sum of digits of an integer number that has been input by the user. So first you have to ask the user to please enter the number. Again, I have stored it in the num variable. Then since I have to find the sum of the digits, so I am taking a variable sum1 and initializing it to 0. Okay, now what is the logic of this program? How will we perform this task? Basically, when you have to extract digits from a number, what you can do is you can extract the digits from the back side, from last to front, and then you can keep on taking the sum. And how will you do that? You'll do that by taking the modulo of 10. That means, suppose if you have the number 1, 2, 3, if you perform 1, 2, 3 modulo 10, it will give you 12 as the question and 3 as the remainder. And that 3 is itself the last digit. Okay, now the remaining number is 12, which was the question that we obtained. Okay, now what is happening? You again perform modulo by 10. 12 modulo 10 would give you 2 as the remainder, and now your number remaining is 1. Then 1 modulo 10 would give you 1, and in this way you have extracted each and every digit of the number that was input. Okay, so this way we'll extract the digit and keep on adding the digits to the required sum variable. Okay, so let's take the number 1, 2, 3 itself. As you can see, the sum of this should be 6. And the print statement also gives us this sum. So as I just explained you, in the variable, in the loop that we are using a while loop. And the condition that we are giving is, as long as number is greater than 0. This is the very number that has been input by the user, and eventually when we keep on taking its modulo and then updating this value to the quotient that we have obtained from the modulo operator, then or you can say you can update this value by taking the quotient or calculating the quotient separately. So when you perform this, eventually the number will come down to zero, and that is when the loop will stop. Okay, so initially you have, say, the number 123 or 123 is greater than zero, so the first digit would be extracted, and the first digit would be 123 modulo 10, that means 3. So in the variable sum, you will add this digit. So the sum will now have the value 0 plus 3, which is 3. And now you are updating 123, and this value will now become 123 integer operator, integer division 10. Now this will only give you the quotient as an integer, okay? So this will give you 12, and now you will check whether 12 is greater than 0 or not, and so on. Okay, coming to the next question. The next question says, write a function that checks whether the input number is a palindrome or not. Now you have also been told what is a palindrome. Palindrome is basically a number which appears the same, or in the number in which the first and the last digits are the same, the second and the second last digits are the same, and so on. So we can say the number and the reverse of the number are the same when a number is a palindrome. Okay, so how will we are going to check this? First, we are taking the user input. We are asking the user to enter whether the whichever number he or she wants to check, if it is a palindrome or not. So we are taking the user input. Now how to check it? See, we have just now discussed that a palindrome has the first and the last digit as same, and second and the second last digit as same. That means the if we calculate the reverse of a number and then we check and compare whether the original number is equal to the reverse of the number, then we can easily say if the two are the same, then the number is a palindrome. Otherwise, if the reverse number is not equal to the original number, then the number is not a palindrome. So the same logic we have done here. We have stored our original number in a variable temp. We have done this because the original number will now be reversed. We are calculating the reversed of the original number, which will be stored in reversed underscore num. Now, how will we calculate the reverse? We'll be using the logic that we just did in our previous question. Extract each and every digit and then keep on adding it to this particular variable reversed number. But here, what you have to do, whenever you extract a digit, so you extract the first digit from the original number that is now present in temp. Now, how you will add it to this particular variable? You'll multiply the value that is already present in the reverse number by 10 and then add the digit. Now, why is it important? See, again, if I take the same example, suppose our original number is 123. So if 123 is greater than 0, yes, the digit that will be extracted will be 123 modulo 10, that means 3. So the value in the digit is now 3. Reversed number has the value 0. So what will be the output of this particular statement? The reverse number will store the value 0 into 10, that is 0 plus 3. So it is now storing the value 3. But when I go into the second iteration of this loop, when we have updated the value of temp to temp integer division 10, that means now 123 integer division 10 would give you 12. So now temp stores 12. The next digit that will be extracted would be 2. So now when we come to this statement, here reversed num is storing the value 3. If we want to take the reverse of 123, it would be 321. So now we not only have to add this digit 2 at the end of 3, we'll also have to increment the position, the tens, the ones value will be incremented to the tens value when 2 will be appended at the ones position. Okay, so 3 will now be multiplied by 10, it will become 30, and then the digit would be added. So 30 plus 2 will give you 32. Now when you extract the third digit from 123, which is the first one, what will you do? You'll again multiply 32 by 10 so that the position of each digit is incremented. 3 will now come from the tens place to the hundreds place, 2 will now come from the ones place to the tens place, and then you'll add the last digit 1 at the ones place. So the reverse would be in this case 3 to 1, and the original number is 1 to 3. So both the numbers are not the same, and the print statement should tell us that the number is not a palindrome. So let us check, number is not a palindrome. Now let's enter in palindrome, say 1221, and this number is a palindrome. Okay, now coming to the last question of this video. In this, you have to write a program to find the grade of a student when the grades are allocated as given below. So how are grades allocated? If the percentage of marks is above 90%, you'll have to grade the student as A. If it is between 80 to 90%, the grade will be B. Between 70 to 80%, C. 60 to 70%, in that range, the grade would be D. And if it is below 60%, the grade would be E. Now, in this case, it is a simple and classic example of an if-else ladder, or if elif ladder rather, I should say. Why elif? Because there are more than one condition to check. Okay, now you have to be very careful here what would be the order in which you would be checking the condition. Okay, so if you are first, you will be taking the percentage as the input from the user. Here I have not converted the percentage into an int, rather I have converted it into a float data type, because the percentage can be in float. Okay, so now first we check whether the percentage is greater than 90. If yes, then this print, the grade is A. Otherwise, if it is greater than 80, now when I write this particular condition, I'm not checking whether P is greater than 80 or less than and less than 90. Why I'm not checking the upper limit? Because obviously, if I have come to this condition, the first if condition would have been false. That means the percentage would have been less than 90 or equal to 90. Then only the first condition has become false and the control has shifted to the second condition, and so on. Okay, so you don't need to check that, it would be just redundant. So that is why, again, I have checked the respective conditions, and at last, I have printed all the grades. When the last condition has also become false, that means the percentage is not lying in the range 60 to 70 also, at the end, I have directly written the last else statement, and that will give me the last value. Okay, so there is an error percentage. Okay, so this has to be a comment, then only it will be executing. All right, so if I say enter the percentage of marks, if I enter 14, then the grade is E. Now if I enter say 94, the grade is A. Okay, so that was all for today's lecture. Stay tuned for more questions from this chapter and other videos on the Python programming language. Thank you for watching. Till we meet in the next video, mind your exam.